Good morning, friends.
So the effective length is nothing but the length of the spring which is effective in sharing the stresses, or the length of the spring which is effective in sharing the loads. That is called effective length. Since the band or the central bolt which is used to hold all the plates together causes some stiffening or tightening, right, which may not share the load or which may not share the stresses, that's why that length will be considered as ineffective length. So the effective length is equal to total length of the spring, 2L1. This is nothing but distance between the I ends of the leaf spring minus length of the spring, right? So divided by 2L1 minus 2 by 3 of L. So this is when the central bolt is used. When the central bolt or U-bolts are used, and this is when the band is used. Okay, so generally every leaf spring consists of both the full length leaves as well as radiated leaves, right? When there is only one full length leaf, that will be considered as master leaf or main leaf, then the number of leaves to be cut will be equal to n. Right? If there is only one full length leaf, there is only one full length leaf, the number of leaves in the leaf spring will be considered as n. Suppose if there are two full length leaves, then the number of leaves to be cut will be considered as n minus 1. Okay, so this difference you need to identify. For example, if a leaf spring has two full length leaves, then here is the method to find out length of the leaves, right? So we'll start from the smallest leaf onwards, right, till L minus 1th leaf. Okay, so length of the smallest leaf is equal to effective length divided by N minus 1, because there are two full length leaves here. If there are two full length leaves, total number of leaves equal to n minus 1. So effective length divided by number of leaves, n minus 1, plus ineffective length. Ineffective length is either small l or 2/3 of small l. Similarly, length of next leaf, right, we are moving from bottom to top. Bottom you will have smallest leaf, and the top of it you will have next smallest leaf, right? Like this, you will have a stack of leaves in the leaf spring, right? So effective length divided by n minus 1 into 2 plus ineffective length is common for all the leaves. Similarly, the length of next leaf, effective length divided by n minus 1 into 1. Effective length divided by n minus 1. N is number of coils plus ineffective length. Like this, we'll go on calculating the values of the leaves starting from the bottommost leaf to topmost leaf. Right? And the last one is, the last calculation is the master leaf. The nth leaf will be the master leaf, since the master leaf has eyes on both sides. Right, then the length of the master leaf is equal to 2L1. It is the total length of the spring plus 5DT into 2. Right, D is the diameter, inside diameter of the eye. T is thickness of master leaf. So you will get circumference, outer circumference of the eye end. Right, because we have two eye ends into 2 plus 2L1. You will get total length of master leaf. So that's how we can calculate length of all the leaves of master, length of all the leaves of leaf spring. Is it clear? So when there is only one full length leaf, number of leaves will be considered as n. If there are two full length leaves, right, you need to do the calculation for n minus one leaf. Length of smallest leaf, is equal to effective length divided by n minus 1 plus ineffective length. So here the equation is common, only you will get multiples here multiplied with 1, 2, 3 and so on up to n minus 1. Okay, for the master leaf you need to consider this the circumference of I ends so that you will get length of all the leaves. Okay, so these things we will do in the calculation of a design proportions of leaf spring. Okay, then the approximate relation between radius of curvature and the camber y of the spring. Camber is the vertical deflection, right? So it is given by r is equal to l1 square divided by 2y. R is equal to l1 square divided by 2y. What is r here? R is the radius of curvature. Initial radius of curvature, how much we need to give, that we can calculate from this equation, right? Initially you will have a flat plate and this flat plate is bent to the certain radius of curvature. What will be the value of this radius of curvature? R, right? That r is equal to l1. What is l1? Half of the length of the spring, right? So distance between the two I ends, centers of I ends, will be considered as 2l1 divided by 2. You will get l1 here, l1 square divided by 2 into y. What is y? Y is the camber. Initial deflection is considered as the camber, right? And this is only approximate relation. Now if you want exact relation, y into 2r plus y is equal to l1 square. L1 is half span of the spring, right? So you can l1 square by y minus y by 2. So that's how you will get exact relation. Instead of this, and this is approximate relation, you can easily remember, right? Radius r is equal to l1 square by 2y. Okay, so these are the few design proportions you need to consider while designing the leaf springs, right? Then the material used for the manufacturing of leaf spring, right? So the material used for the manufacturing of leaf spring is usually plain carbon steel. Plain carbon steel having carbon percentage of 0.9 to 1% carbon. Okay, so it is a low carbon steel, right? So you have the carbon percentage up to 2%, is it right? So here the carbon percentage is just above the integrity point, 0.8. It is above 0.8, 0.9 to 1% carbon, right? So here we need to consider some special properties as far as the leaf springs are concerned. Hence the leaves are heat treated, right? So the heat treated leaves will have some of the good properties like greater strength, greater load carrying capacity, greater range of deflection and better fatigue properties. All these terms are self-explanatory. You can easily explain the terms like strength, load carrying capacity and deflection and fatigue properties, right? So here the spring is used in the application where the variable loads are common, right? When you keep a leaf spring or even your helical spring in the application, right? So whether it is a machine or automobile, whatever it is, generally it is subjected to variable loads. This variable load may be a cyclic load or a fluctuating load or a an alternative load or repeated load, whatever it is, right? When a member is subjected to variable loads, the fatigue failure is common. The failure of the member, right? Below its prematured, below its predetermined life, right? So that is called a fatigue failure, right? So to avoid this, it should possess certain properties like strength. Strength is nothing but resistance to deformation. And similarly, the load carrying capacity, resistance to load, it is also said to be a strength. The load carrying capacity of the leaf spring will be increased by going for the heat treatment process. We have so many types of heat treatment, tempering, annealing, right? And night riding like this, we have so many heat treatment process. You can go for any heat treatment process here, right? And greater range of reflection. If you want a cushioning or the spring functioning properly, it should have greater range of deflection, right? So then only you will get the shock absorption or cushioning effect using this type of springs, right? So all these properties are obtained only by heat treatment process. Okay, right? We will see the commonly used material for leaf springs used in automobiles and railroad cars. So for automobiles, generally plain carbon steel of 50.5% chromium, right? So sorry, 0.5% carbon, right? Chromium, and this is the composition of two different types of steels, right? Silicon manganese steels, right? So here the carbon percentage is 0.55 only. These are all the alloy steels, right? So all used in hardened and tempered state. So the heat treatment is necessary to get good leaf springs, right? So similarly for railroad springs, these are all the commonly used leaf spring materials. C55 steel, C75 steel, similarly alloy steels like 0.4% carbon, silicon, manganese, similarly 0.55% carbon, silicon, manganese steels. So these are the commonly used leaf spring materials for the manufacturing of leaf springs. Okay, right? I think it is clear.